Hi and welcome back. We're going to study judicial review and activism. And before we start studying judicial review and activism, one must understand as to how much of it is actually relevant as far as, you know, our exams are concerned. Because in the gullies of the coaching hubs and online platforms, judicial review and activism seems to be a very hot burning topic, and there are of course countless hours of discussions on it. But you must also understand that the UPSC has to be very careful with the way they ask questions on this. In fact, if you look at the previous year questions that we've sort of discussed at the beginning of this particular theme, you would understand that there have largely been questions which have been very case law oriented and very, very conventional as to why is judicial review important? How is it one of the basic features? What was held in some important judgments like IR Kohelo and case Ananda Bharti? But that is it. You would also understand this in a different domain, that you would not particularly get a question that says, where is the problem? Why? What do you have to say about judicial adventurism or judicial overreach? Because fundamentally, judicial overreach is a bad idea. Fundamentally, the judiciary stepping into things that they have no business stepping into is a bad idea. So, of course, it's a bad idea. And it must not happen, and it must happen as rarely as possible, and it must happen in the most rarest of the rare occurrences, and it as much as possible should not happen. So the UPSC is not going to really get into those domains. Yes, in the discussions on judicial review, in the discussions on PILs, we would get into how sometimes the judiciary does things which is not strictly adjudication of disputes. It gets into sort of laying policy, laying legislations, or you know, playing more of a role which is beyond just a judicial one. So one has to be very careful, and one must also study this with just the right amount of detail. So how we're essentially going to go about this is we're going to first understand the meaning of it. We will then understand the need or why is it important. Once we understand the need or why is it important, we'll understand very basically on what grounds and on what reasons can you go to court on this. Right. And then you could look at the differences between judicial review, judicial activism and judicial overreach. We'll then understand with some very detailed examples of this. And we'll basically the line of thought that we'll keep here is that the reason courts are getting into domains which don't strictly belong to courts is largely because of the action or the inaction of the other branches of government, because there is a void to fill. The LE and J are supposed to constitutionally be equal. And beyond just the point of being equal, the democratic mandate would lie with the legislature and the executive, which means they'll have the first right of passage. When the legislature and the executive are collectively not doing a very good job of policy making or are not doing a very good job of upholding constitutional values, then there is a void that is created. And when that void is created, the judiciary tends to sort of step in, and you know, sometimes that step in becomes an overstep. So that's the larger theme that we would sort of keep through as far as this particular topic is concerned, and I'll go through it and I'll give you some very interesting examples to substantiate your answers here. Because the key to writing a good answer on judicial review, much like ethics, is the diversity of examples that you could give to substantiate your answers, right? Apart from this, of course, I will be also giving you a database of important judgments which you could quote not just in polity but across other portions of your GS syllabus, such as social issues, governance, ethics and so on and so forth. And of course, quote them in your essays as well, because they also become fairly important. Right? No. So, the idea is the ultimate power of the judicial system in India is to determine and to basically figure out the validity of a law. And this law is anything which has a legal effect. So whether it's an order, it's an ordinance, it's an administrative action, and so on and so forth. Now, the power of the court, right? The power of the court to inquire into whether that specific legal effect is a constitutional conflict, is a constitutional violation or not, is what is fundamentally called judicial review. And judicial review is how you keep a check and balance which is necessary as an outcome of separation of powers. So in your introduction itself, you must link judicial review to checks and balances, which then owes its origin to separation of powers. And there are two basic objectives of judicial review. One is to legitimize government action, which may sometimes seem questionable. And second, to ensure that while we are a parliamentary form of government, we're also constitutional supremacy. And while the parliament has the powers to amend the constitution, to evolve the constitution in its own right, but the constitutional values as enshrined by the makers of our constitution, the true essence and the will of the constitution must always be protected by the judiciary at all costs. And that's the larger discussion. Now, when we look at it, let's understand why is judicial review needed. See, judicial review is needed for the following reasons. First, at the end of the day, India has a constitutional supremacy, which means the constitution is above everything else, and not just the constitution. Within the constitution also, fundamental rights have been given a higher stature. We all are aware of Article 13, Clause 2, which very clearly says that no law in the country can violate fundamental rights, and if a law does so, then the law would be deemed to be null or void, or the law would be declared to be unconstitutional. And it is the duty of the judiciary to declare a law null and void, which seems to be violating a fundamental right. At the same time, if there are certain actions which are taken by the government, as for example, we were studying in the case of tribunals or amenability of fundamental rights, there were certain actions which were taken by the government which questioned the very constitutional ethos that the country has been built on. So whenever those core constitutional value questions arise,
Case then moves on.
it is the Supreme Court who has to rise to the occasion. It is the Supreme Court who has to make sure that this is taken care of under all circumstances. Now, apart from this, when the judiciary performs a function of checks and balance by making sure that it very clearly identifies this is the job of the legislature, this is the job of the executive. You can't go beyond this in terms of figuring out not just center state disputes, but also executive transition or legislative transition. Or, for example, keeping a sort of check on the way ordinances are issued, or keeping a check on the way the executive can sometimes transgress into legislative powers, or say giving the two pieces on delegated legislation. When the judiciary gives a judgment on an ordinance, like for example in the Wadhwa case or the Krishna case, the judiciary is basically restricting the executive from crossing a line. So when the judiciary is restricting the executive from crossing a line, it is basically making sure that the executive does what they're supposed to do, the legislature is doing what they're supposed to do. So by performing a check and balance function, what you're essentially doing is separation of powers. Third, by doing this, and we're talking about this in the second point also, that you're also able to maintain a certain sense of sanctity in a federal government. Now, India essentially is a federal state. It's a federal state with a unitary bias, with of course the center having stronger powers than the state. But that does not mean that the relations should always be against the best interests of the state, or the center may have a right of force or a right of coercion over states. And the integrity of the center and the integrity of the states both have to be balanced under all circumstances. And the Constitution, through articles and of course Schedule 7, has very clearly laid out the limits of how much the center can do and how much the states can do. And in case there is an inconsistency, or in case there is a repugnancy of sorts, or in case there is a dispute between the center and the states, it is up to the judiciary, which means an independent judiciary is essential for federal equilibrium. If you want federalism to be successful in a parliamentary democracy with a two-layered government, you have to make sure that the judiciary gets the powers to keep a check on how the two layers of government are interacting with each other. And that is why they've got to be impartial. That is why they've got to be independent. And sooner or later, it's inevitable. Whether we look at interstate water disputes, whether we look at disputes between the center and the states with respect to taxation, or the very fact that the original jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is the fact that the Supreme Court gets into center-state relations. And these become extremely important, and these have to be taken into account under all circumstances. Now, fourthly, where the Constitution does guarantee these fundamental rights, the legislative violation of these rights can only be scrutinized by the court alone. This basically means, this very simply and very basically means that when fundamental rights are being enforced, they could be enforced through a law, they are enforced as it is, and sometimes you could make laws which may compromise the integrity of fundamental rights, like it happened in the Section 60, say, IT Act issue, or for that matter where things like sedition are, of course, a larger question of law and morality at the same time, or when we look at laws such as Section 377 of the IPC, which had to be watered down, which had to be decriminalized because they were fundamentally violating fundamental rights. The only people who can sort of determine the legitimacy of this, because the governments don't seem to evolve or the governments don't want to sort of review their own laws, is obviously ending up with the judiciary. So that's it. And not only this, there are also two other very important reasons. And I was talking to you about this at the beginning of this lecture, that there is a void, and the void will often have to be filled by somebody. And I do understand if a military rule is a problem, so is a judicial rule, because fundamentally, both the judiciary and the military are appointed offices. They're not elected offices. But the inaction of the other two organs of the government, right, in terms of making the right kind of laws, in terms of making the right kind of schemes, whether it's in the social sphere or the economic sphere, there has of course been an issue of say an over promise and an under delivery. And this is exactly where the judiciary sort of steps in, pulls up the government for action, for inaction, tells them to do a bunch of things, tells them to not do a bunch of things, sometimes takes tougher actions also because they have to. And there have been cases where, you know, the government has also left it to the wisdom of the judiciary, for the judiciary to take tough decisions on issues. And the government could then follow suit with those tough decisions because they're usually going to be right decisions. And then sort of place this decision before the country and say, you know, the judiciary said so, we've got to do this now. And say tougher decisions on, say, for example, recognizing transgenders as the third gender, decriminalization of homosexuality. Now, as a parliament, we should have done this before the judiciary did so. But the judiciary had to step in at the right time. We needed the Navdeep Singh Johar case. Now they're, of course, looking at an advanced judicial sort of pronouncement on allowing people of the same gender to also attain the status of a civil union, which is basically allowing homosexuals to get married. So those things are now being dealt by the court. The parliament is also very happy because these are tougher decisions, and the courts have to, you know, take those calls. Sometimes the courts also, you know, are in their own right. They don't get into the technical details of it. Like, for example, the court will tell you that yes, transgenders are officially the third gender, but they will also recommend to the parliament to then come up with laws that give transgenders the OBC status. And not only this, you also have to then fill a legislative vacuum, because often laws don't get made. And this is amply evident in the Vishakha case, wherein for about 14 years, the Vishakha judgment served as almost a law preventing sexual harassment against women at the workplace. And that's essentially how it is, and that's essentially how it should be. Right? Now, if you see, when I was explaining the need across both of these two slides, with every need, I substantiated the need with the right amount of examples. And that's exactly how answers on judicial review and activism must be written. Now, everything beyond this is essentially substantiation. So the subjects of judicial review could essentially be if a fundamental right is being violated, if there are other legal rights or constitutional rights that have been violated, if there are any laws or executive actions which are violating constitutional schemes regarding separation of powers, checks and balances, basic structure which has been also evolved as an important part under Keshananda Bharti, or in terms of let us say there is a transgression of the rules where, you know, delegated laws or delegated legislations are breaking the original intent of the law, whose technical details they have to sort of execute. And at the same time, if there are any limitations or any restrictions that have been carved out under the law, they seem to be reasonable or not. Now, very specifically in India, both the Supreme Court and the High Courts have the powers of judicial review. Why? Because under 32 and 226, both the Supreme Court and the High Court can look into issues of fundamental right violations. And under 226, the High Courts can look into issues of legal right violations. Now, for example, if X law is violating a fundamental right, this is something that both the Supreme Court and the High Court can look into. So the Supreme Court and the High Court are effectively judicially reviewing that law as it violates a fundamental right. Second, it could also be conducted across all central laws, state laws. And judicial review is not about whether an incident happened or not. It's about whether a law is right or not. Right? And of course, it's very important that we have something called the Ninth Schedule, wherein judicial review cannot be conducted on laws which are placed in the Ninth Schedule. The Iyer Coelho case did say that unless if the law is violating basic structure, then judicial review can be conducted. Otherwise, judicial review can't. This is also one of the reasons why one of the state laws on reservation, exceeding reservation beyond 50%, can't be challenged, because it's A, in the Ninth Schedule, and B, reservation is not basic structure. And judicial review usually cannot be undertaken sua moto by the courts. Now, of course, a sua moto is something that, again, is blown higher out of proportion than actually it is. For example, in the last 15 years or so, not more than 50 sua moto cases have actually been taken up by the Supreme Court. And we're going to cover sua moto powers and should courts have sua moto powers in theme 6, which is essentially the judiciary. Now, there are certain advantages and disadvantages of it. The advantage is that it, of course, keeps the misuse of power in check. It makes sure that there is a mechanism for protecting people's rights. It insecures the independence of the judiciary, and the judiciary doesn't let itself get bullied into something. And of course, the National Judicial Appointments Commission is an unfortunately stellar example of the same. And of course, it helps the courts exercise what their constitutional duties are. Disadvantage is that it's fundamentally undemocratic. The courts are not the most well-institutionalized systems. They're essentially an internally appointed ecosystem. And there are no dedicated guidelines on it. So what is judicial review, under what circumstances can it be undertaken or not, is also a matter of judicial evolution. So the courts are telling you what is judicial review. The courts are telling you how much can we judicially review or not, which basically makes it an internally regulated system. And third is that this could lead to a certain unhealthy amount of power with the judiciary. And the judiciary's power could then be counter-affected by certain actions of the parliament. For example, when we see the amenability of fundamental rights timeline, right, from Shankari Prasad, Sajjan Singh, to the 17th Amendment, to Golakh Nath, and so on and so forth, then the 24th, 25th, 26th, 29th Amendment, then Kesananda Bharti, then Minerva Mills, and in between we have the 42nd Amendment, the 44th Amendment. It always was almost like a two-fro sort of a mechanism. And that's not a very healthy thing to do, right? And there have always been reversal of previous decisions also. Of course, both the Supreme Court and the High Courts are courts of record, which basically means two things. One is that everything which is submitted in the court is evidence, and two, they have the powers to review their own judgments. And if they didn't have the powers to review their own judgments, then A, you would not evolve. But then there has to be a reasonable ground to review those judgments. For example, Golakh Nath was completely reversed in the case on Ananda Bharti judgment, right? So there are, of course, those basic decisions as well. Now, the terms that we often use are, for example, judicial review, judicial activism, and judicial overreach. Now, each of these three mean very three slightly different things. And at the outset, I must tell you, this is also a matter of perspective. What is judicial activism to you may not be activism to me, and what is overreach to you may not be overreach to me. So what I've attempted to do here is I've given you the least hurtful examples. I've given you the least objectionable examples so that almost most students watching this would agree. To get into controversial examples is a problem on two counts. One, you may not believe in it. And two, you may offend the examiner in the first place. And at the end of the day, the examiner is, you know, your constitution as an exam, as a student. So what are the primary differences in the definition? Judicial review basically means a process through which the judiciary reviews the validity of the laws. Judicial activism is where the judiciary takes a more active role and tries to not only look at the validity of the laws, but also looks at... Also looks at the enforceability of it, the socio-economic aspect of it, looks at how well the law is functioning or not, right? So those things, like for example, very recently, the Supreme Court took absolute offense to the fact that despite them declaring Section 66A of the IT Act to be unconstitutional, why were cases still being filed under Section 66A? Why were FIRs still being filed under Section 66A? And the difference between judicial activism and judicial overreach is when the courts have literally stepped over to the other side, the darker side, if you'd like to call it that, where the courts start making laws through their judgments, start telling the governments, you know, how to execute certain actions. For example, when the court cancels your spectrum licenses and your coal licenses, the court does not really have the power to do so. And they shouldn't have the power to do so because it's the government who decides who gets to mine coal and how are spectrum licenses to be distributed. When the court tells you how to redistribute coal licenses, I think that's a problem. When the court gets into telling you what kind of crops should you be growing, how should your policies be undertaken, that's not the court's job. You're not an elected office. You do not enjoy the democratic mandate. So that's essentially what judicial overreach is. Except for judicial review, none of this has any constitutional backing. In fact, none of these words are actually explicitly mentioned anywhere in the Constitution. And you could use that as a point as well. Whether it's judicial review or activism or overreach, none of these three words are actually mentioned as explicitly in those exact words in the Constitution, right? And that's extremely important. However, the origin of judicial review is in Article 13, more specifically Article 13, Clause 2, which also says that no law can be violating a fundamental right. Whereas judicial activism and overreach don't necessarily have a legal origin or even a legal context or a constitutional context. Take a very simple example. For example, when the court declared in the Shreya Singhal case, Section 66A of the IT Act to be unconstitutional, it basically struck down Section 66A. That is judicial review. Then when the court looked into why are FIRs still being filed, and the court gave directions to the government that you should inform the heads of the state, you should inform the police heads and the civil servant heads, the DGPs and the chief secretaries of the states, and ask them for measures that they've taken to inform the local administration. That is judicial activism. So, for example, when the Supreme Court in Shankari Prasad, Sajjan Singh, Golaknath K. Sananda Bharti, when they were looking at whether the land reform laws were violating 14, 19 and 31, that's judicial review. But when they go a step ahead in K. Sananda Bharti and they come up with the concept of basic structure, that is fundamentally an activist concept. For example, the most popular way of how judicial activism actually happens is through public interest litigation. Then we're going to talk about it in the series of these lectures only. And like, for example, the judiciary tells you that you should not smoke in public places. Now, I might have a conflict of interest on this one, but I do believe it's a It's a good decision that was given by the Supreme Court, which was later then adopted by the Parliament, and they actually made a law specifically banning smoking in public places. Now, how effective is that law and how effectively is it being enforced is a different question altogether. But this is essentially what judicial activism is. Now, judicial overreach would be like, for example, the Allahabad High Court in 2015 saying that bureaucrats must compulsorily send their children to schools makes no sense. Or, for example, where all cinema halls have to necessarily play the national anthem before featuring a feature film in the country. So, if you see the same thing when gone beyond a point, is the difference between review activism and overreach. And that's something that we have to be very, very careful of. When we look at some important judgments around this, and I'll give you, these are your foundational judgments with some foundational examples. And then, of course, I'll give you some extended examples also. So it was actually in the Sampath Kumar case. We've discussed the Sampath Kumar case in tribunals as well, which is why I gave you that case in the first place, is where Justice Bhagwati very clearly established that judicial review was a basic feature of the Constitution. Then again, in the Chandra Kumar case, which we've also discussed when we were discussing tribunals and the timeline of it, that the power of the judicial review is vested in the High Court under 226 and Supreme Court under 32, and is an essential and ingredient of the Constitution, and again reiterating that this is also a part of basic structure. A simple example of judicial activism review would be the Navtej Singh Johar case, where the Supreme Court decriminalized Section 377 and said it should not any no longer include physical intimacy acts between two genders, which are the same. Judicial activism, on the other hand, is not recognized by the courts, and no judgment will say judicial activism. You will never hear any judgment by using the words judicial activism or even judicial overreach, which is also why no UPSC question will use the words activism or overreach. They will push you to use those words in your answers, and you should use them rather carefully. But you would not find this word in a judgment anywhere. So, for example, the Indian Young Lawyers Association versus State of Kerala, where the judiciary allowed the entry of women into the Sabarimala temple. This is an internal matter, it has a religious angle to it. While the judgment is perfectly fine and what they've done is laudable to essentially eliminate an age-old practice which prevented menstruating women from entering a religious place of worship, undoubtedly made no sense, and the Supreme Court was right to do so. But the question is not about whether the Supreme Court was right to do so. The question is, why did the Supreme Court had to do it in the first place? For example, when we look at the Puttuswamy case, where they declared, where they announced a new fundamental right is implicit under Article 21, which is the right to privacy, which essentially played catalyst or cupid to the Navtej Singh Johar judgment, is essentially an act of judicial activism. And of course, the most popular and the most mostly written example, in approximately about 6 out of 10 answers that I correct, I would always find Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan as an example on judicial activism, which is a good thing because this is one of the most substantial examples of judicial activism, because here what you're essentially doing is creating what is called judicial legislation, which was also asked previously in the exam, and I don't think it's going to be repeated that soon enough, nor would you get a direct question on a PIL at all. When we look at it from a provisions point of view, there are several provisions in the Constitution which give the courts the powers to review a few things. Most people will quote 13, 32, 226, but then you also have other powers. For example, under articles between 131 to 136, the Supreme Court has the powers to adjudicate disputes between the individuals in the state, states and the union, and of course, the interpretation of the courts on the Constitution must be validated and respected by all other courts of the land. Article 143 allows the president to seek the opinion of the Supreme Court. This is nothing but the advisory jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, which is essentially executed by the president, which is again where the Supreme Court can give an opinion on the validity of a law or the validity of an action. And there are essentially two things. One is, of course, a question of law from a matter of public importance. And secondly, any dispute which is arising out of a pre-constitution treaty or a pre or a pre-constitutional enforcement agreement, covenant, and so on and so forth. Article 145 also gives the Supreme Court the power to frame rules or on conditions on which a person can practice before a court, which itself means that you have the powers of judicial activism. Under 227, the High Court will have superintendence over all courts and tribunals in that specific state, which means the High Courts will essentially be the courts of administration or the head courts of administration for all the lower courts, which also means that they'll have the powers to make certain rules. Under 246, Clause 3, you ensure that the state's legislative powers are pertaining to the state list. Any transgression of this could be looked into by the courts. Under 251 and 254, that in case of inconsistency between union laws and state laws, the state law will be void. And who will decide this? The courts of the land. And of course, 372 clause 1 says that you can also judicially review pre-constitutional legislation, which of course when read with 143 also makes sense. So now the basic question is that if the judiciary gets to do what it gets to do, does it violate the parliamentary democracy? Has it sort of taken over the role of the executive and the legislature? See, judicial review is primarily criticized on two grounds. First, that it is the legislature that should be making laws, and two, the judges themselves are not elected in the first place. So when the judges start making laws and the judges are not elected by the longest streak of imagination, then it is a fundamentally undemocratic practice, which means the institution which wants to uphold the principles of democracy is not having a democratic mandate, sort of makes it slightly hypocritical. And therefore, since the courts are not representing the will of the people or the mandate, they often are not competent enough to know what is it that people really want. Thankfully, the courts of our country have been progressive. Thankfully, at least the Supreme Court of our country has been largely progressive, has largely been forward-looking. But that does not mean that the Supreme Court has not had a dark past. We all remember the emergency era. We all remember the ADM Jabalpur case. We all remember how a junior judge was made a chief justice by superseding three other judges. We've seen some dark times of the judiciary as well. But that does not necessarily mean that there will always be dark times. Similarly, there is a counter view to this. The counter view to this is that while the composition of the judiciary is not democratic, but the accountability of the judges by the way they demonstrate their decisions, that instills a degree of democracy. So whenever Supreme Court, or in fact even the High Courts, whenever they give a judgment on a social issue, on an economic issue, on a political issue, which affects the people as a whole, there will always be a degree of reaction from the people. For example, when the first uniform civil code case had come out and the Supreme Court had mentioned about how we should really have a uniform civil code in the country, there were massive protests. Similarly, Supreme Court's judgment on Sabarimala, there were people supporting it, there were people disagreeing with it. When you struck down homosexuality, there was a massive support. When, for example, you legitimized and gave a sense of identity to transgenders, there was support, and there were, of course, questions on the other side. So there will always be some form of reaction by the people of the country, thereby making it a more holistic process. But again, honestly, this is a very far-fetched argument. Now, the conclusion to this is that when it's about the void theory, when the legislature and the executive are either incompetent or apathetic to discharge their duties, and the bureaucracy is not working in its full efficiency to sort of secure and uphold the rights of the people, the only person who's left is the judiciary. So you could either say that none of the branches of the government do a good job, or you could say that, all right, two of them aren't, at least one person is. So this may not be by choice, this may not be by competition, but this is the only alternative that we have. So that's essentially how it happens. So but fundamentally, does it undermine democracy? It does. But why does it undermine democracy? That can be justified. Now there are of course some detailed examples on this, and you can go through this. For example, the Golaknath case, the Kesananda Bharti case, Vishakha guidelines, very recently adultery was was abolished. Now, for those of you who don't know what, and I'll give you a database of all of these judgments so that, you know, you have it all in one place and you can use it in 10 other places. So abolition of adultery was basically this. A lot of you may have a little bit of a confusion on this. So abolition of adultery has nothing to do with an unmarried female. Has absolutely nothing to do with an unmarried female. The discussion here is there's an unmarried male, there's an unmarried, and there's a married male. Okay, and now there is a married female. So if a married male and an unmarried male has a relationship or has some association with an unmarried female, it's okay. But if a married male and an unmarried male have a relationship or an association with a married female, that was an objection, because then they would essentially go to jail, and that's when they would essentially be held responsible. So this was, of course, decriminalized, and this was decriminalized because there was a lot of feminist movement around it, because you're essentially treating women like property, and of course this was objectionable in its true right. Now, whether it's decriminalization of 377, abolition of triple talaq, various judgments where you protect environment and ecology, abolition of bonded labor, ban of smoking in public places, the Olga Tellis case, a very, very popular one where the right to livelihood was sort of upheld, creation of the collegium system in the judges transfer case, the institutionalization of PILs, providing midday meals to school children, giving declarations on witness protection, in fact ruling on narco analysis, these are all essentially judicial activisms. Now similarly, the courts have also entered into fields which were traditionally sort of left only for the legislatures, for the executive. For example, by issuing very specific directions, like for example the Shriram fertilizer gas leak case, it ordered the plant to be closed and said that victim compensation funds must be set up. In the Dehradun quarrying case, it closed down limestone quarries in Missouri. The government was also asked to appoint a committee to look into issues of bad loans, also asked the UPA government, the government before the current one, to set up a special investigation team to investigate black money, which was of course later used as a tool of political propaganda, and also looking at a better drought management policy. There have also been cases where the judges have sort of gone a little beyond what they should have. For example, banning liquor, patriotism in the national anthem case, setting up the Lodha committee to reform the Board for Cricket Control for India, which is largely a private body. Though we understand that the BCCI is infested with certain structural issues and it could be a better organization, but to set up a committee by the Supreme Court to regulate a fundamentally private body is just a little objectionable. Right? Now, if you want some more examples to quote to make your answers better, this is where I sort of come in. From a historical context, the origin of judicial review is a very, very famous American Supreme Court case of Marbury versus Madison. And for those of us who've gone to law school, and for those of us who studied constitutional law in any degree of depth, would definitely be familiar with it. GS students, just quote Marbury versus Madison. You don't need to know the details of it. This is more than enough. Then, of course, the Avengers, Shankari Prasad, Kesananda Bharti, Sajjan Singh, Minerva Mill, Indira Gandhi, Raj Narayan case. Classic judicial review cases. In the Chandra Kumar case, the Supreme Court actually gave you three dimensions to judicial review. That first, you have to ensure justice in executive action. Two, you've got to safeguard fundamental rights. Three, you've got to decide on issues of legislative competence amongst the union and the states. There are certain examples of judicial activism also, where rights of life, vulnerable sections and the poor factions of the country were upheld. The Bandhwa Mukti Morcha case, the Neecha Chaudhary case, and the Public Union for Democratic Rights. In the exam also, if you just quote these names, that's more than enough. Because of a conflict of interest, the Murli Deora versus Union of India case, where the Supreme Court directed that smoking must be banned in public places. A welcome judgment indeed. But sometimes the Supreme Court has really, really stepped across. And that essentially is judicial overreach, wherein the judiciary had censored Jolly LLB 2 for a limited period of time, because it, of course, had certain objectionable scenes with respect to how the judicial system of the country works. When the judiciary struck down the National Judicial Appointments Commission, which was in a sense a good idea to create a more transparent judicial system. In the Shyam Narayan Choksi versus Union of India case, the national anthem case, where it has to now necessarily be played in cinema halls, is an example of judicial overreach. In the Tamil Nadu versus K Balu, wherein the Supreme Court had banned the sale of liquor within 500 meters of any national highway. And you know how innovative Indians are. I'll give you an example. So there is a highway called NH8, which connects Gurgaon to Delhi, and just where Gurgaon begins, there is a very popular, it's a business district which is also called Cyber City, and also has an entertainment hub called Cyber Hub. Now, Cyber Hub also has all sorts of recreational eateries serving liquor. Now, after this judgment, there was of course a problem. So what happened here was that the judgment was that it can't be 500 meters, which means 500 meters of road length. So they made zigzag roads in such a way that the zigzag roads were about 500 meters plus in length. So you have to give it to Indians for how innovative we are as a bunch. So these are some examples. What is your conclusion? That judicial review is the unconditional, inevitable response to ensure there is a check on exercise of power. There is a thin line indeed between activism and judicial overreach. Just as independence of judiciary is basic structure, so is the sanctity of our legislatures, so is the primacy of the legislatures in lawmaking. Parliamentary democracy is as much a basic structure as independence of judiciary is, and as much as judicial review is. So while yes, it is important, but it does not mean that we start looking at judiciary as the be all and the end all of it, and we should not be indulging in judicial romanticism by abusing the public interest litigation framework. And that is why you will often see PIL, judicial legislations, review, they're often asked together because they're essentially feathers of the same bird. And it's not that a judge should never be an activist, of course, but this should be done in the rarest of the rare cases where there's absolutely no other option left but to do this, right? And it is only to further the mandate of our constitution, where a legal norm is required by society for its smooth functioning and smooth running, and those should be the primary reasons. And given the role of the judiciary in the protection and the evolution of law of the land, it is extremely important that the judiciary desists from or resists itself from making judgments or making decisions that sometimes, may be very short-sighted and sometimes may be unacceptable in terms of democratic standards. And this is all as much as, judicial review and activism is concerned. And because I said so, public interest litigations are in fact the most common forms of it. And just quickly run you through public interest litigations. A citizen can file a PIL under 32, 226, and of course Section 133 of the Criminal Procedure Code in the court of in the magistrate's court. A lot of people don't know this, but this is legal knowledge. You write it, you'll sound cooler in your exams. The idea is that the court must be very satisfied. PILs have to be first admitted. You don't have the right to a PIL, right? So the court has to be satisfied that there is a genuine need which requires a public interest litigation. And of course, the courts are often treat letters as also as acceptable mediums. In fact, you'd be surprised to note that most PILs are actually entertained in the form of letters. Not even 10% of the PILs which are filed are actually filed in the form of civil or criminal writ petitions. As far as the locus standi is concerned, which means what is the relationship of the person who's filing the case is concerned, first is that it could be a letter addressed by the aggrieved person, or it could be a public-spirited individual, or it could be a social action group for the enforcement of the constitution or the legal rights of a person or a class of person who, by reason of poverty, disability, finds it difficult to reach. So, which means an NGO can often also file PILs. And a PIL can also be filed against public bodies or authorities, but necessarily a PIL cannot pay a against a private institution or a private body. To give you a little bit of context, on an average, the Supreme Court receives about 25,000 PILs in a year. Very interestingly, 2019 was the year where the highest number of PILs were filed at the Supreme Court, about 70,836. If you go back in history, the first PIL which has been recorded is actually 1979. And I've mentioned this case in the subsequent slides also, in the case of Hussain Ara Khatun versus the state of Bihar, wherein there was some relief which was sought for under trial prisoners who've been languishing in jail because of judicial delays. Most recently, it has been used in the context of the pandemic, and not only PIL but suo mutuo litigation has also been taken care of by the Supreme Court. The constitutionality of the Muslim marriage practices, questions on our abortion laws, and all of those things have also sort of been taken into account in the context of PILs. Now, as I was telling you, most of them are letter petitions. Very few are actually formal writ petitions. And letter petitions are, in fact, entertained more than writ petitions. This makes sure that anybody can write a letter to the Supreme Court and say that this just doesn't make sense. Can you please understand that we are being affected by a larger context? And this is why a PIL becomes important. Right, there are certain subject matters you'd usually see: bonded labor, neglected children, exploitation of casual workers, minimum wage issues, women issues, environment issues, food adulteration issues, heritage culture issues. There are some landmark PIL cases: Hussain Ara Khatun, MC Mehta, which was essentially environment, Vishakha, which is again something that we've discussed before, Parmanand Katara versus Union of India, wherein you have to make sure that doesn't matter even if it's a legal issue, it might be a crime, but if there's somebody who requires medical assistance, don't worry about it. The Good Samaritan law must always prevail. PILs have certain basic advantages. The advantages are that it makes sure that you're able to access justice for everybody who needs it. Two, it makes sure that economics, power, social status, they are not impediments. Third, it helps you exercise judicial review. Fourth, it also helps the judiciary look into how good or bad is the government with respect to policy implementation. It democratizes the very idea of justice. It protects human rights in its essence and also allows for judicial monitoring of state institutions. There are also certain specific disadvantages as well, because what happens is at the end of the day, somebody is getting to court and somebody is not. Right. Now, for example, when you file a PIL and you say that shut this industry down because it's deadly to the environment, the workers of that industry are going to be at a disadvantage because they're going to lose livelihood. So how do you balance the right to environment versus the right to livelihood, which also, by the way, is a brilliant ethical conflict to quote in your answers. There have also been cases of frivolity, of malfeasance, of you know, the wrong intentions or malafide reasons for which the PILs have been filed. And this, of course, leads to a colossal waste of time of the court. This also leads to a massive negligence of the court. And there are, of course, potentials for judicial overreach, which the court sometimes can get carried away and, you know, sort of violate the doctrine of separation of powers. And PILs, if are not solved quickly in a reasonable amount of time, can also lead to an inordinate delay in the disposal of cases. So this is it for judicial activism review and PIL. I don't think you'll need anything more than this as far as the upcoming mains exam is concerned. See you in the next theme. Thank you. And by the way, yes, read ADR and Lok Adalat from the same PDF file, which is on the cloud drive. There's nothing that has happened on those fronts, and I don't necessarily expect a question from that this year, but still, to be on the safer side, still go through the PDF. UPSC is known to be UPSC. Still prepare alternate dispute resolution and Lok Adalat and go for the exam. You'll find the notes in the extension of these slides itself. Thank you.